We've previously talked about the NordBord in our athlete testing series and focused a lot on the force generated as well as the asymmetry metrics. But today we're going to dive into the impulse metric. This was a question from Christy Edson, a sports scientist and strength and conditioning coach currently at Orlando Pride, about how useful impulse from the Nordic hamstring exercise is. So thank you, Christy. And if you have a question or a topic you'd like to see discussed in this series, then please do comment below or get in touch via social media. I'm Joe Clubb, sports scientist and founder of Global Performance Insights, which is a company providing sports science consultancy to teams, practitioners, athletes, and sports tech companies all around the world. Let's start by defining impulse. Impulse is a function of force over time. And we previously talked about this in more detail in my video on jump heights, because the impulse momentum method is one way of calculating jump height. Impulse is essentially this area under the curve, whether we're trying to determine that during a jump takeoff or during the NordBord. We can think about summing all the force created over the time period to then determine impulse in Newton seconds. So here we have an example of an export from VALD's hub from their NordBord data. We have a couple of athletes here who have each done 3 reps in this trial on the left and right side. We get our maximum force on left and right side, along with the imbalance between those two. I have another video talking all about asymmetries and the whole variety of calculations that you can use to calculate imbalances and asymmetries. I'll link that below, so have a look at that video as well. So this force is the maximum point measured, whereas this is the average over the 3 trials. So torque is rotational force, so the force generated in this case around the knee, and this is calculated by force times length, which is determined by the knee position in the settings. I have to be honest, I have not used this too much myself. Probably the best use case for it perhaps is in youth athletes where their limbs are growing and you can keep a track of the torque that they're generating in both as their force increases as they mature, but also as their limb length increases as well. And then we have our impulse measure. In this case, we've got the maximum impulse from the 3 reps on the left and right sides. As I mentioned, it's measured in Newton seconds, and then also the imbalance between the two. So firstly, let's think about impulse in terms of between athlete comparisons, as is the case here. Now, remember, impulse is calculated as force over time. And therefore, the tricky aspect of comparing between athletes is that a difference between athletes in impulse could be just a function of the time, because we don't really constrain the time an athlete has to carry out the Nordic hamstring exercise. So here I have 2 examples of athletes' data, and we can see that their maximum force and their average force is very similar. In fact, on the left-hand side, it's pretty much identical. And yet we see a massive difference, more than twice as much impulse generated by athlete 1 compared to athlete 2. So let's take a look at their force traces. So we can see the 2 force traces here. And because the graph automatically adjusts to fit, we might not necessarily instantly see a big difference. But actually, if we look at the time of the different reps, we can see that athlete 1 is really doing their rep over the course of about 10 seconds on average, 9, 10, 11 seconds. Whereas athlete 2 here is doing their reps over about a 4-second period. So they are generating a similar amount of force, but doing so over a very different time period. And that's what explains this difference of about 10 to 11,000 Newton seconds, so impulse for athlete 1, compared to about 4,500 Newton seconds for athlete 2. It is purely a function of time. If you are going to use impulse, then you certainly do need to dive into the force traces between the athletes and take a look at the time that they're doing the Nordic hamstring exercise over, because that could be an explanation of notable differences in impulse. What about within athlete comparisons, and particularly within trial, where we might look at the impulse generated by the left side compared to the right side? So again, here I've got two athletes. We're going to look at them one by one. And in this case, just looking at the maximum force measure and the imbalance, and then also the maximum impulse measure and the imbalance. So firstly, athlete number three, we can see in their case, a very noticeable asymmetry, about 19% here, then between the maximum force generated on the left side versus the right side. But when we're looking at impulse, then we're only seeing about a 5% difference. So let's take a look at their force time curve to try and understand why this difference. This is a really interesting force time curve from this athlete because remember, there is a greater magnitude of asymmetry in the maximum force metric than the impulse. We can see clearly the difference in maximum force between the left and right sides. The reason the impulse asymmetry is not as high is you can see here earlier on, this the right side, the orange series, which is clearly based on maximum force, the weaker side, they are engaging that earlier in the Nordic hamstring exercise, outputting higher force in the earlier stages of the Nordic exercise. And remember, impulse is this area under the curve. So this difference earlier on, this higher amount of force generated on that side is what then reduces that total impulse asymmetry. Now we're going to look at another example, which is ultimately the opposite. So athlete number four here, we can see very similar left and right side max force generated. But we're seeing a 15% difference between the impulse on the left and the right sides. And again, when we dive into the force time curves, we start to understand this a little bit more. Remember there, we're just looking at the max force asymmetry and outputs that's generated from this first rep here, where this blue series, the left side, is ultimately able to reach a similar peak on that first rep, although interestingly, appears to fatigue quicker in the second and third rep, not be able to maintain that output on that left side. So whilst the maximum peak is very similar, again, we're seeing this difference between the two curves. In this case, the right side, the orange series, is consistently greater, is creating more force throughout the whole rep of the Nordic hamstring exercise, therefore has a higher area under the curve. And that is what explains this greater difference in asymmetry between the left impulse and the right-sided impulse. So in summary, I'm not sure how useful the between athlete comparison of impulse would be. We might have to start trying to constrain the time period over which the Nordic hamstring exercise is done. And I'm not certain on the research behind that or the applied practice. And ultimately, if you're constraining the time, then you're just looking at the difference in the force generated. But I think within athlete, and particularly looking within trial left to right side, there may be some value to looking at the impulse generated, but always in the context of other metrics, as well as then looking at that force trace and understanding the area under the curve to appreciate how that impulse was generated. If you want to know more about the NordBord and the Nordic hamstring exercise, then have a look at my other video in this athlete testing series. And I want to thank VALD Performance for sponsoring all the videos in this series. I hope you found them useful. If you did, please like and subscribe and come back again soon for another Sports Science Insights video.